For decades, charities have been making an impact in caring for those in need. Yet the operating environment for organisations, and particularly not-for-profit organisations and charities, is increasingly complex. Organisations are navigating technological change at the same time as tightening regulations and reporting, demographic and generational change, as well as rising cost of living pressures, which are all altering the giving landscape. So understanding the psyche of donors, therefore, is pretty critical to ensuring sustainability and future impact. So joining me today to discuss the insights from our latest report that delves into some of the changes and trends impacting the future of the not-for-profit sector is a key author in the report and McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Soph, welcome back to the podcast.
Hey, Ash, always a delight to be here.
I know that the not-for-profit sector is important to you personally. It's important to me and to our whole team, which is why we invest such resource into running this big annual report and study and virtual event and infographic in true McCrindle fashion every single year. And so for the last few years, you've been instrumental in this report and are this year as well. What significance do you see this report having for the charities and not-for-profit sector?
Yeah, I love being a part of this report. It's a fantastic, I guess, gift in some ways to the not-for-profit sector and charities who are doing such incredible work across our nation. And what I love about this report is that it really allows charities and not-for-profits to get a sneak peek into some of those giving trends more broadly. It allows them to maybe even see their data or understand their donor base in the context of the broader trends that are happening across the sector. And I think what's really powerful or really helpful with our report is that it focuses more on the, I guess, psychographic or the motivators or the underlying reasons behind giving, more so than just behavioral transaction data, which is really powerful and a really important piece of the puzzle. But we try to go a little bit more broadly and a little bit more deeply to understand how those things are shifting. So is it established organizations or startups that people are choosing to give to? Is it those with a local or a global focus? Is it long-term solutions or meeting immediate needs? It helps us understand those attitudes and perceptions more broadly.
Yeah, it's a really fascinating report. You authored it and was a really instrumental part of crafting the questions and analysing everything. And then I kind of got to come in and just, not just, but present some of the insights in our
virtual
event.
You did a lot of work.
Thank you, Soph. Not as much as you, I don't think. So I've got the right person on the podcast today to have a talk about this. But I think as well, in terms of just our listeners, like it was amazing to see in the report that I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's 84% of Australians engage and give to not-for-profits, which is a high proportion. So I imagine 84% of our listeners are, you know, engaged and givers to not-for-profits. So it's interesting to, as you mentioned, not just talk about what causes people care most about, which we did investigate, but like you said, the motivators behind it, the future, the impacts of even engaging emerging generations, which I think every sector and every organization is sometimes struggling with, but things that impact the not-for-profit sector in terms of how they operate, the expectations that we as donors have, that most of the money that we're giving from our hard-earned taxpayer dollars is going to the cause. Like there's almost like a different way of operating. So we definitely wanted to acknowledge that in this report, and I think you did a great job in that. So a big question next up for you, what kind of shift do you think that we are seeing take place within the not-for-profit sector today and that's impacting kind of shifts as we look to the future?
Yeah, one of the really interesting shifts we're seeing is the changing donor engagement for the generations. And similar to organizations more broadly, as you just mentioned, every organization and every industry is trying to grapple with how do they engage this next generation? What does that look like to do it well? And one of the things that we're seeing in the not-for-profit sector is actually, reflected in broader society overall. And it's a shift from institution to cause. You can see it in politics where it's a shift from the party to the policy. And people are more focused on the why or the driving factor behind something, and their loyalty is to that, not the institution or the organization, which can have some challenges when you're looking at how to engage. So particularly this emerging generation, is increasingly cause-driven. We asked a question, as we always do as researchers, when considering giving financially to a charity or a not-for-profit, which of the following matters more to you? And we found that for almost 7 in 10, the cause or the area of need matters more than the familiarity and the reputation of the charity. And that's quite, I guess, an astounding statistic, particularly for those charities that have been in the sector for a long time, that just knowing that it is the cause rather than the organisation itself that really drives engagement. And so that loyalty is no longer to the institution but to the cause. And, yeah, we've been seeing that shift across society more broadly. And as always, it is our younger generation that are often the ones that are driving change. And for 3/4 of Gen Z, the cause or the area of need matters more. Gen Y is 70%, Gen X is 67%, and then baby boomers are at 59%. So all Australians really hold that view that it is cause more than organisation or institution, but our younger generation are really the ones that are, I guess, driving this cause. And we often like to think about, in McCrindle, we're like, okay, so here's a stat, here's some of the broader context that's going on, but how do people respond? What do they do? How can we actually equip them with something that can help bring some positive change in their organization? And what we've been wrestling with, and our advice to charities in this context, is really to explore how to amplify the cause within your messaging, not to just solely rely on your organization or your brand, but to look at the why behind what you do, the particular cause, the reason that you exist, and then providing multiple opportunities for people to engage with that cause throughout the year to really engage this next generation of givers.
That's really fascinating. I think as you were sharing those insights, I was thinking about, I guess, like comparing it to, say, the past, where there weren't as many organizations, there weren't as many charities, there weren't as many not-for-profits. And I guess those who were operating to further a particular cause or solve a particular need or help a vulnerable group of people, whether that's here in Australia or overseas or disaster relief or animal welfare. We know there's lots of different types of organizations with causes. But it's interesting where this loyalty is no longer to the institution or maybe to the organization, but it's to the cause. I can imagine for not-for-profits, that's hard when now today, like say, and I don't know, I don't have the exact data to back this up, but I imagine that say 3 decades ago, there was a smaller amount of organizations per cause, whereas today I imagine there's micro charities, there's social enterprises, there's just more choice available for givers, which makes it harder for organizations to appeal to a particular donor base or a generation and keep that loyalty. But then you've also got this trend where there's not this loyalty anymore as much loyalty anymore to a particular institution, but it's to the cause. So it's like, well, there's these 15 or 20 or 50 charities that are trying to work on a particular cause. And as a donor, you've got so much more choice. So I guess for organizations, if we're thinking about someone who's working in a not-for-profit or a charity, that's quite a challenge. Is that kind of what you're seeing as well in terms of the charities, the organizations that you consult to, that you advise to, Soph?
Yeah, that is what we're seeing, that people are still being generous. Their generosity is just shared amongst more organisations. And so the financial impact to a particular organisation is that from one donor, they're getting, I guess, less of a piece of a pie of their overall donation, which can be challenging to reconsider how to engage and in what ways to engage which generations, and what's going to work for one person might not work for another. So it is really challenging to, I guess, evaluate what has worked really well for a long time, not throw that out, but explore how do you adapt the offering and the engagement to this next generation.
And I think about this next area that we explored in the report, which was kind of around brand legacy. And I think that's interesting in light of what we just talked about, because we've kind of said the cause matters more than the familiarity or the reputation of the charity or the not-for-profit. But how then, Soph, do you see brand legacy playing a part in this? Does it impact given behavior? Is that still a relevant aspect? We know trust is really important. So where does brand legacy fit into this kind of increasingly complex picture?
Yeah, and I guess we do have some good news for those more established brands, that brand legacy still does play a part. So if you can have a great cause and then a strong brand legacy, that can actually position you really well. So don't fear fully, but there is a catch probably to this conversation. So we asked the question similarly, like, which are you more likely to give financially to an established charity or not-for-profit, or to a startup charity or not-for-profit? And we found that 64% of donors are more likely to give to that established charity or not-for-profit. So that brand legacy does play a part for almost two-thirds of donors. But 36% do prefer to give to a startup charity or not-for-profit. So that's more than a third of donors, which we've not run this question before, but I would say my hypothesis is that that would be higher than maybe a decade ago it would have been, where that, I guess, sense of knowing and trusting was possibly stronger. And it's interesting when we look at this by generation, and I feel like I say that phrase so often in every presentation and every podcast, but we're generational experts, and it is interesting when we look at it by generation, and we can really see that our older givers, they really favour that established charity, at 86% preferring to give to an established charity or not-for-profit. It shifts, though, when we get to the next generation. And for Gen Z, they are far more likely to favour a startup organisation, with 61% of them preferring to give to a startup charity or not-for-profit. So this positions, I guess, charities in a little bit of a dilemma of, okay, well, how do we respond? We know that for our older generation, that our brand legacy plays a really key role. But when we're looking at future-proofing ourselves and engaging this next generation, that they are more likely to favour a startup organisation. And we also know that they're increasingly cause-driven, particularly the younger generation, more so than the older generation. So cause-driven startup, that feels not, I guess, against what established charities are, but there's probably just a few more hurdles to overcome to really position your brand like that. And we would really encourage, particularly those established charities, to look at this as an opportunity to explore how can you think like a starter in the offering and the ways of engaging to captivate this emerging generation of givers. And then if you look at what this new, I guess, emerging charities don't have, is that they don't have this brand legacy. That's actually a unique differentiator that you have. So how can you turn that into an asset in the way that you've got this trust, you've got this legacy, but how can you partner or pair that with innovative ways of engagement that maybe a startup brings? And I'm often talking with charities, and this is maybe just one of my hypotheses at the moment, but around, you know, how can you leverage that unique asset of the brand legacy and ask yourself that question of, do donors actually know your history? Do they know your journey of serving people for 100 years? Do they know actually how you've innovated, you know, in each decade to meet the need that has been there? Because this world is very uncertain. There's a lot of change. There's a lot of complexity. And that is, I guess, fun for an emerging generation. But then if they can also see a proven track record of innovation along that journey, that you have been a rock of dependability of serving people throughout it all, my hypothesis is that if you can engage in fun, fresh, new ways, think like a startup, and bring that story of dependability and legacy and impact, I think that could be a really unique way to engage this next generation of givers.
Yeah, I think that's fantastic insight and fantastic advice, Soph, in terms of not throwing everything out to appeal to a new demographic or a new generation who do have different giving preferences and different ways of engaging and motivation. There are still timeless human needs that we all have, but they're being kind of expressed, I think, or encountered within in different ways, in different platforms. So not to throw everything out, but to actually maybe position that or tell that story in a new format, or not just innovate some things or tweak some things to appeal to this new donor base coming through in the emerging generations. But that was fascinating as well. I think that 61% of Gen Z would favor a startup. That's incredibly different to the overall population or the average, you know, among Australians. So it's really being driven by these younger consumers, which again, as we think about Gen Z, just as a reminder for our listeners, you know, I remember when I started at McCrindle, Gen Z were like in their teens and they were really young and they were like really the emerging generation. And they still are young and some of them are still in their teens, but the oldest of them, like, and it's amazing. Anyone who is in their 20s today belongs to Gen Z. So we're talking about at the older end of the generation, some people may already start to have kids. They've probably been in the workforce for a few years. They haven't had a lot of economic power behind them, but that's always changing as the generation, as the cohort ages. So it is interesting. And now I guess some organizations are starting to think about the alphas coming next as well, who are too young for us to survey at this point in this particular study. But, you know, the oldest of them are 14. So yeah, it's interesting to see that. But so one thing that I loved about the report and the insights that you brought, particularly to our virtual event where we share these insights. I saw some of your notes that you were prepping for this, is the considerations for leaders, because we try so hard to not just be a social research company that just drops the stats and then is like, good luck, everyone. Goodbye. We want to come on the journey. We want to help. We want to advise. And of course, we love doing that when we get to go into and do a strategy workshop with a particular organization or a not-for-profit's board. Of course, we understand that not everyone can do that, and we don't have the opportunity to do that with every charity. So our kind of other way to do that is to put in these reports and presentations and virtual events some application points or considerations for leaders. And I know that you spent a lot of time crafting and honing these, and I think they're fabulous. So I wondered, Sophie, if you could just expand on some of these for our listeners today.
Sure can. And I love what you said there, that we do really love supporting organizations and being able to equip people to make better decisions. Like that is why we exist, is that we believe when people have the right information, they can make the best decisions for their organizations, people they care about, the people they lead. And that's what we're always trying to do, is get the fresh information, to get a snapshot of what the landscape is and going, okay, how do we respond? And how do we keep the core there? And how do we innovate on the edges so that we can keep remaining relevant? And so there were three keys that we really wanted to equip not-for-profit leaders with. And the first is with that shift from the kind of institution to the cause, that the application of the cause is absolutely crucial. So more so than the familiarity with the charity, people are driven by the cause. So how can you as an organization look to increase the amplification of the cause, particularly when people are giving, when they hear about a need or an issue? That message cut through has never been more important. So what are the different tools in your toolkit that you can use to amplify that message? What are the different platforms that you can use? What are the different ways of engaging? Is it verbal? Is it video? Is it imagery? How can you amplify not just your organization, but the cause that you are really wanting people to engage with and support, as we know and understand that it's the cause more than the organization that drives giving? So the amplification of the cause is crucial. That was our first, I guess, key recommendation or key consideration. The second is actually understanding your unique donor base. Today, we've talked through donors broadly, so that everyone that's given at least once in the past year, that's a snapshot of people that we've been talking about today. But every organization is unique in its mission, in its donors, in the motivations for why people have chosen to engage with them. So really take the time to understand your audience, your donors, and your people. And how are they similar with the broad trends? And maybe how are they different, so that you can actually meet them where they are at? Because we know that we need to change and adapt to stay relevant, but innovation isn't actually about changing the people that you're trying to serve or changing the people that you're trying to engage with. It's about changing the market or the industry to better serve those people. So sometimes it would be nice to be like, oh, this is too hard, you change. But no, how do we change, or how do we change the market to actually engage you in a better way? So to do that, We really need to understand the unique donor journey that we have within our organization to achieve that. So we love partnering with organizations to almost just open up that black box of who are their givers, how do they engage, what motivates them to give, to equip you to make those decisions, informed decisions of the data that's yours to be able to really engage those donors better. And the third, which if you're wanting to maintain the status quo, I apologize. Not really, but a little bit. The third is to adopt a disruptor mindset. So where we started, that across society, there's a big shift from those institutions to the outcomes that, you know, people aren't aligned to the political party, but to the policies. Even in the banking world, there's been a shift away from those big four banks to the disruptors that are really customer centric. So it's no surprise that it's really impacting the not-for-profit sector of that shift from institution to cause and from established to startup. So in that, I guess, context, there is a need to adopt a disruptive mindset to really future-proof the organizations, and particularly those that are established. How can you lean into that startup way of engaging whilst also partnering that with your brand legacy to build engagement?
Amazing reflections, Soph. Amazing applications and takeaways for people. I think, yeah, there's so much there. There's as we've mentioned at the beginning of the episode, it's not an easy environment for any organization to navigate, let alone the not-for-profit sector, with even all the disruptors that every organization's facing, like demographic change, AI, technological transformations. But then you've got, you know, the rise of the social enterprise and different ways of generations giving, that's kind of adding another layer of disruptors to organizations who may have got that really strong brand legacy and are kind of thinking, how do we ever so slightly change? And I love what you said as well about keeping the core the same, but changing something or an action or a way of engagement or a marketing strategy on the peripheral. So we're not saying throw everything out and just adapt and change for the emerging generations. Of course, that's not the message. The message is understand through data and insights and your unique donor base, as you mentioned, so that then the innovation is strategic and the innovation is targeted and the innovation hopefully yields a really great return on that investment, which we know not-for-profits and charities are held in very high regard, understandably, that they've got a high level of accountability in terms of how they're spending fundraising money and donor generosity and all of that. So really great insights there around the amplification of the cause, understanding your unique donor base and adopting that disruptor mindset, which is always easy to talk about on a podcast and harder to do in person, but so worth it to remain relevant and to keep helping those vulnerable people and vulnerable communities and helping our society become better and more flourishing, which is, yeah, how we like to think that we help through the use of data and insights, even in this particular way. It's, I think there's a really nice link for us in terms of the research we do, the Excel spreadsheets that we're vigorously analyzing and the reports that we're writing and the podcasts we're doing and the link to human flourishing. And we know that the not-for-profit sector plays a really significant role in that for Australia and for countries beyond. So amazing insights today. So thank you so much for coming on the podcast and for all the work that you put into this report as well.
Pleasure. Looking forward to the next one.
And if people are interested in delving deeper into some of the insights that Soph shared today, we of course will have a full research visualized report. Shout out to our design team who do an amazing take amazing care in bringing that research to life. We'll have an infographic summary as well. And there's a virtual event that we have referenced a few times that we're running that you can also watch back. So all of that is available at McCrindle.com. So if you're interested in delving deeper into that, please do head there. And just in general, if you'd like to stay up to date with our latest insights at McCrindle, you can always subscribe to the podcast to get our latest episodes. You can follow us on social media or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.